You're snap, the guy's big, he lifts me up off the ground, my legs fly off the ground, and I wrap the baton around his neck, choke him down, drag him away. This guy's like 6'8", probably like 300 something pounds, much larger than me, and has big afro. The other guy's like 6 feet tall, has long hair, wiry guy. My other team member takes him down, takes him up, and then we take him away in the van. And then when we got him in the van, you could hear like the kicking of the arms and legs and flailing. And we got known as body snatchers, according to the police, from that day forward. That was their word for us, the body snatchers. And what was so funny was, to this day, the police have never talked to me. To this day, they've never talked to me. The way I found out about this is a retired police officer, she came up to me and she said, after she hired me for security for her jazz artist, she's in the production company, and in retirement, and she was like, oh my God, you're that company? We were investigating you for being body snatchers. We called you guys a body snatcher. You took these two guys off the street and abducted them. I was like, oh yeah, no. She was like, no. I was like, yeah, we don't abduct people. So I got this video. What's interesting is I got the owners, the people that I worked for, the building owners, they were interested in liability because they heard about us abducting these guys and beating them and taking them away. So they came to town to fire me, two extremely rich guys. And so they're sitting there like, oh my God, show them the video, like, my God, look at that, you just abducted these men, I gotta fire you, this is liability, oh my God, what are we gonna do? I was like, well, first of all, you really think I did this crime, then I filmed it, and then I showed it to you? That's just disrespectful, right? But also, think about this, if I abduct bad guys, why wouldn't I abduct rich guys? I was thinking, like, you guys are not very smart to be really rich. Luckily, I'm a good guy. So I said, first of all, we don't break the law, number one. Number two, I wouldn't film it if I did. And number three, I would never show it to you. He goes, well, how do you explain this? I mean, I see the guys gurgling, screaming, and you choking them guys. And I said, those guys work for me. The two guys that we choked and beat, it was a rubber stick. The guy with the afro, the next day he cut his hair. That was his first day. He applied for a job. And that was the first day the two guys started. They have long hair. One had afro, one had long hair. They both had to cut it to be part of our team the next day, so nobody ever recognized them. And they were in uniform. And so this day, they looked like two of the worst thugs ever. One had actually, he was a football player at Wayne State University, a lineman, and the other guy works for the post office. But behind him, and this is the gray area, there was a real danger part here, there were four real drug dealers behind them. And the four real drug dealers, when those two guys came forward, they took off running. So, like, that was lucky. This is a rubber stick. This is not going to work out good if it's a problem. And we have no guns on site out here on the public streets. So we just took these guys away. They weren't. There was no violence, no fighting. From that day forward, including to this day, there are no thug dealers, no violence. People are, that's a family-friendly environment right around there. The criminals stayed away from that day forward. No more violence. So no drug raid, no beating, no arrest warrant. We just did some street acting and it had a psychological effect. I remember one police officer came into a place we're eating. All my staff, we were downtown, and this giant cop comes in, a sheriff is like, who's in charge? I was like, oh God, what do my men do now? Oh Lord, me. I'm like, no, please, what do they do? He was like, I'll just shake your hand. I was like, yes. He goes, my mom lives in that area. She's lived there since the 60s. This is the first time she ever felt safe going to the store. She sleeps at night knowing that your men are out there, and thank you for being there, and thank you for making my mom safe. I was like, wow. That's a close one. I'm scared for a minute. Well, that's good, sir. Yes, I was thinking the same thing. Exactly what I was thinking you were calling me for. And so the bottom line is everyone's a winner when we don't have violence, and we don't have to use violence to stop the violence. So it was the psychology that made the difference. I was able to get criminals to leave just because we pulled guns on them. When I first started, a woman came to our door. She said, please help me. She was crying, so the police won't help me. I was my boyfriend, he was carjacked by these guys. They took the car, it's around the corner from you guys. I have three kids, I work at McDonald's, I'm trying to get my kids. And I was like, the police will help you. God, so dramatic. These people. I called the police. I was like, hi, yes, the security over at this building. And there's a lady here, says the police won't help her. Her car's around the corner. Some armed men have it. She'd like to get her car back to get her kids from the babysitter, daycare. And so the police were like, well, they have the car now? I said, yes, sir, they have the car. He's going to come over here and just help her get a car. We don't do that. I was like, stop it. I was like, sir, you do that. You're the police. And someone has their someone's car. They have a gun. This gunman, they have her car. This is America. She has her car. She bought a car. She's at work. She has to get her kids. And you're the police. She's go over there and get her car back. He's like, no, we don't get involved in such things. I was like, I cannot believe that. So I called back again. Same thing. We don't get involved in that. I was like, well, we do. We're Americans, not Americans. Oh, excuse me. We're Americans, not Americans. So we got our rifles, and within 5 minutes, she had her car back. 5 minutes, we had her car back in her custody. That's counting the walk, because we had to walk around the corner. So we walked around the corner with our rifles and shotguns. We got into a position, we got cover, and she went to go to her car, and men came out with guns, like on television, and they said, get away from the car, we're going to shoot you. And I came out in the middle of the street and exposed myself, and I said, if you lift that gun, I'm going to have to shoot you right here, right now. The criminal looked at me, he believed I would shoot him with his 12-gauge, and he was exactly right, because I had to be willing to die and kill for this lady who just wants her car to protect her family from poverty and suffering. And so that's the kind of moment you have to have. You have to have that kind of commitment. Had I been smarter, which I got smarter later, I could have done that differently with less lethality. But I wasn't opposed to the use of force and violence. It's just I learned a better way. So I tell you that because, yes, you do have the option to go up with the rifle and secure and do the right thing. But you can also do it nonviolently. And that's what we do now. So now I know how to secure communities and neighborhoods without violence. So in that situation, what I would have done is pulled up in a very impressive vehicle with an impressive number of blacked out stormtroopers, and then we stand there and the person gets their car and then we leave. That's how simple it is. Right now, I'll give you an example. We pull up, I pulled up on a guy, he's hunting, he's got his hoodie on, he's in all black, and he's walking, and he's hunting. So he's literally like walking without a purpose at 3 o'clock in the morning. So he's kind of like drifting like that. Or like walking like a zombie. So I pull up next to him, and I got the iPhone out and my vehicle, and I said, how you doing, young man? He goes, fine. He goes, why are you filming me? I said, sir, I have to film you to show we're being respectful and polite. It's one of the things they make us do. I don't know who they is, but they make us do that. Those people. Us. So he's like, oh, okay. So you're not trying to get evidence on me or something? I said, no, sir, we're not trying to get evidence on you. We just got to show we're being respectful. I said, listen, you know, you got to be careful out here. There's lots of criminals. Have you seen any criminals while you've been out tonight? He was like, no. I said, well, be careful. He goes, I'm not doing nothing. I said, good. Good, you shouldn't be doing anything. And we got to make sure nothing happens to you. Because you're in Detroit on 7 Mile, and it's very dangerous. There are criminals. They might try to rob you. So we're here for you, sir. Young man, we're going to be right behind you. If anybody tries to rob you, you just let us know. We'll come up here and rescue you. Okay? He's like, okay. So then I go, now, one more thing. We have another option for you, too. If you'd like, you can be on our good person file. He's like, what? I was like, our good person file. If you give us your ID, if you'd like to do that, we'll put your ID in the good person file. So if the police think you did something illegal, we can prove to them you didn't because you're in the good person file. He's like, what a good person do right now? Your choice. He's like, oh, yeah, I'd like to be the good person file. I was like, click, you are in the good person file. Have a good night. Right back there behind you. He goes, well, I go to Wayne State, I'm just jogging. He's got a good story. I was like, it's great. Well, don't you like this? You're going to, whenever you go jogging here, these are public streets, these communities we work in. You can actually get free bodyguards. There's like a president of the United States while you're jogging. You have bodyguards right behind you. Who gets that? It's all free. He's like, oh yeah, you're right. Do you think he ever came back, ever, for his free bodyguard services? He also didn't get arrested for committing crime or anything else. And so what we do for communities and corporations is create nonviolent outcomes. There was hijackings in a movie called, cigarette hijackings called Beverly Hills Cop 1. You may have to YouTube that. Anyway, Axel Foley, this police officer, is holding on to the back of the truck. They're stealing cigarettes. And I remember thinking as a kid, like, who's going to steal cigarettes? That's dumb. Apparently the mafia has been stealing cigarettes since the 40s or 30s or something. So fast forward to the 1998, we get contacted because apparently the hijackings are approximately $100,000 a month. And in one case, they took a $1 million truck. They abducted the helper, the driver, took him to another city. So now the client is out of insurance options. That's what happens when you keep getting robbed. So they get referred to us, and a police officer helped me get this contract. The way he did it was this $250 million company, his contact is referred to us. I go to him. He says, what are you gonna do? I said, well, we'll protect you, blah, 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 protect your payload. He was like, have you done it before? I was like, absolutely not. All we do is beat up thugs and that kind of stuff, violent gangs. He was like, oh, well, thanks for coming out. I was like, wow, I guess I won't get that deal. And so this police officer, as I'm walking out, he's walking in, he's a bodybuilder. He walks in, he's like, hey, Viper. That's they know us as. VIPERS is an acronym. It stands for Violence Intervention Protective Emergency Response System. They call us VIPERS. And so he goes, hey, Viper. And I remember this police officer seeing him around. He's a bodybuilder cop that has an off-duty company of police officers. So he walks in, he goes to the guy that owns the company. He goes, hey, do you know who just left your office? He goes, yeah, I don't know. I'm not gonna, I don't know. He was referred to me, but he talks like Brian Gumbel. I'm not gonna hire him. Everybody talks like that, can't fight. He's too smart or something. So the guy was like, well, it's a good thing you're not gonna hire him because his people are barbarians. This guy's just a barbarian. You know, if you want people hurt, that's what you call it. They're all barbarians. They just hurt people. The guy was like, what? The guy just left here has barbarians? He was like, yeah, but I have off-duty cops, ex-special forces. We're all armed. We're all, all cops. And he goes, let me get this straight. You want me to hire cops who couldn't do off-duty? You want them to do off-duty what they couldn't do on-duty? Does that make sense? He said, well, you know what? The guy that just left here, you just got him the job. I wasn't going to hire him because of the way he talks. But I'm going to call that guy back, and you got him the job. So the guy was mad. He was like, what? So from that day, since 1998, we've been working. My men are bodyguards on cigarette trucks. The company's now a $300 million company. They're the biggest cigarette distributor in California, Vegas, and Michigan. And that's one of our bread and butter accounts. We stopped all the hijackings. Something that was costing them millions now costs them zero. Then another company was referred to us in 2006. The guy was hijacked four times in 1 week. We stopped those hijackings completely. He's not been hijacked since the day we started in 2006. The communities we protect is about 5,000 residents now. We have zero court dates. Those six of us have been shot in the first 6 years, which would be 95 to 2000, say 2001. None of us have been shot since then. And none of us have had a court date. We've had no lawsuits. And we've been in the media maybe 40 times. Internationally, RT came out with us. We've been in Holland, some people from Holland and Belgium, France, M6 have come out with us, rid along with us to see how we do this. They also came out to see the zombies. There's no zombies in Detroit, so you know, it's not true. And lately, Viceland came into the story on us and came out to Detroit and rode on our boat with us, went out to the community with us to see how we protect people. And we do it without creating violent outcomes and without creating adversarial conditions. Psychology, law, and skill is how we do that. Our objective is to deter, detect, and defend. And the way that we're able to manage these issues is by constantly training. Constantly training. Everything we do requires more and more training. So our objective here is to help set up a school so that you guys can create safety right here in this community. And so that we have a network of people that are trained in how to manage human threats nonviolently. Does anybody have any questions? Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Oh. Which one of us?
You.
Okay.
You were the first.
Yeah. So I apologize because I just wandered in here. I don't know any background information.
Yes.
I lived in a very high crime neighborhood in New York, and I did research on the statistics. And it's not for that neighborhood, but for like many high crime neighborhoods, the police statistics always say the majority of the violence is men against men, and that the violence toward the shootings of men towards women and children are so minimal. And I'm not asking this to minimize if that ever happens. But I'm curious because what you said is the opposite, and yeah. I believe you.
Yeah.
But I'm wondering, like, what are the statistics like propaganda or
they're
like
total why are propaganda? Because if they tell you it's a bunch of girls getting shot, then that means the men are safe. They don't want people to think that women are the ones in danger, men are safe. That just doesn't sound cool. It's not sexy. because then if you're not a woman, then it means you're not in danger. Pretty much that's true. And most of our shootings, let me be clear, seven of my men are dead off duty.
Wait, sorry,
and those men are all dead from fighting over girls. So let me clear about that.
I'm totally confused by the answer. You're saying that the police department statistics are totally lies?
First of all,
unfortunately,
everything they're gonna tell you is almost always articulated in a more palatable form to fit the narrative. That's what I'm gonna say on this mic, on that camera.
And is that, are you coming up with that based on like
experience for years?
Just watching what's happening?
What I do is research. So for me, I research everything. So I want to know, for example, and it's constant for me, furtive gestures have always been a problem for me. I was talking about it in the 90s. People were like, I never heard of people getting shot that are unarmed. Never even heard of that. Where'd you get this information from? I was talking about it in the 90s. So all these cops, state troopers, federal agents are always like, man, you were on top of that years ago. Yeah, because it's been going on since the beginning of time. What's happening is more information. People with cameras are taking photos and videos, and more people are leaking information. And that FOIA stuff is sometimes working out where they actually do respond with truth, which is, by the way, an issue too. FOIAs, you have to be able to enforce a thing. So you could say, I'm going to FOIA you, but what if they don't care? So a lot of information still is not being released, right? And so this information from the inner cities, for example, what I'm saying is true, and this is going to be a hard one. What if what I'm saying and telling you is true? What if we really do go out there and protect people, and we're out there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, we're at 911 calls 9 times out of 10 before any police officers get there, and it's solved before they ever get there? What if that's true in Detroit, in the inner city? What if what I'm saying is true? Then all those narratives and stories, all that was not true. You're talking about thousands and thousands of people injured and killed. But how come we're not killing our homeless? How come we're not killing the mentally ill? We deal with mentally ill people. One guy told a surgeon, President Obama said that he could have his house, his 10,000 square foot house. President Obama gave it to him.